everybody, while you're standing, would you just bow your heads and just welcome and ask the presence of God to come down and be with us this time. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your goodness and mercy, Lord. We pray that your joy and peace would just descend upon each and every one of us this day, God. God, give us your strength and peace and comfort today as we celebrate the life, the wonderful life, where we did that. God bless you, Mary Sandra.
Mary Jean Dunlap, 73, of Bryant City, Missouri, passed away peacefully at his home on February 27, 2024. Mary was born on the 11th day of July, 1950, to Vestal Eugene Dunlap and Rose Arlo Dunlap in St. Charles, Missouri. After graduation from St. Charles High in 1968, Larry joined the United States Army, attended the NCO Academy, and after 2 years was honorably discharged as an E-5 sergeant. Larry went on to study construction and design at Three Rivers Community College, skills that would serve him later as he drew plans in his career as a home builder. In 1971, Larry Dunlap met Diana Urich at church, although he remembered seeing her many years ago. Larry and Diana married in 1973 and had three children, Jennifer, Jeffrey, and Julie. A talented builder, Larry created beautiful homes for more than 45 years. He and his brother Steve worked together for many of those years. They won a Homer Award for a Jefferson Davis replica home that they built in Huntington Forest in St. Charles. He employed several family members, trained many others through the years, including my son. During the 5 years of his semi-retirement, he and Diana worked on many projects together, including full remodels. Due to the great number of homes that he built and the nature of his work, Larry and Diana lived in 34 different homes in their 50-year marriage. Larry had a beautiful voice, talented singer, church, weddings, funerals, with Diana and with his daughters. He was also a talented musician and played the trombone, the harmonica, the fiddle, not the violin, the fiddle. Larry and Diana enjoyed traveling and spent a lot of time together during their retirement at their cabin in Fairdealing, Missouri. In 2014, they enjoyed traveling to Israel together, where Larry was the only one, as I remember it, with the courage to ride a camel. Through the years, they traveled with family members and friends on a cruise to Mexico, enjoyed vacations in Washington, D.C., Salt Lake City, Utah, Tennessee, South Dakota, Wyoming, Florida, and Mackinac Island. Larry was preceded in death by his father, Vestal Eugene, his mother, Lois, and his brother, Daniel Ida. He is survived by his loving wife, Diana, daughter, Jennifer, her husband, Lesh Johnson, son, Jeffrey, and his wife, Amber Dunlap, daughter Julia Johnson, son-in-law John D. Johnson, and grandchildren Jocelyn, Jonah, Jean Claire, Jude, Leah, Sadie, Joel, Jace, and Jesse. Brother Steve and his wife Cindy Dunlap, and sister-in-law Carol Bryant. Today we're saying farewell to a unique man. Maybe the world would be a much, much better place if Larry wasn't so unique. The friends that are here today, and the so many that came last night, represent every era of the life of this good man, and they testify to the kind of man he was. Everyone here has been benefited by his kindness, his strength, his intelligence, his skill as a designer, builder, and his desire to serve the Lord by always being willing to help whatever the need and whoever needed it. I think that the loyalty he inspired in those around him speaks volumes about this man. Larry has left a legacy that will endure. His sense of humor, his wit, his honesty, his kindness, his unfailing, quiet faith will remain with all of us who knew him. We will never forget him. Amen.
I was asked by Diana to make some remarks on behalf of the family. It is my privilege to do that. First, just something spiritual. I speak to family things today. My mind went to the book of Philippians, chapter 4, verse 7. And it states, I'm just paraphrasing, that the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, will fill your heart. That is my prayer today, because the Prince of Peace is here with us to comfort each and every one of you. For those of you who don't know, I am Larry's uncle, but he and I are as close in age as brothers. Often, probably I felt more like a brother. And something was said about his retirement and unretirement. One of the last projects he did was to paint our little religious ball. And we had a lot of fun. I'm so glad for those days. And he said something to me that I'll never forget. Had a little bit to do, and he was going to get out and do it, and he didn't find the time, because he was undercover. But he said, well, really, he said, we waited until you come back from, we're working some for a mission church out in Carroll, Missouri. And he said, it's just, although I waited till you come back, it's just a whole lot more fun when you're here. I'll never forget those words. And it was a whole lot more fun. It truly was. We laughed, we reminisced, and talked about a lot of things. That was, I guess, one of his very last projects that he completed. I want to say something else about Larry before I move into the childhood stories. My brother-in-law, Jerry Eubank, I'm sure he's here. Forgive me for telling this story. He didn't wish me. But he said of Larry that the last house that he completed for them, and I don't know how many he built for Jerry and Diane, that they did it on a handshake. Not a contract, a handshake. You just don't see that. And I think this is a testimony of why so many people are here today, because of his integrity. But I first remember him as a tiny, tiny little baby that Lois and Jean, who is my elder sister, brought to our home there near Fairbanks, Missouri, and oh, he was so small. And he was sick, and we all were very concerned about him. But he made it. I think it's a testimony to his tenacity. He grew to be a giant of a man, not in stature, but in character. He was so, so honest, so faithful. I always remember him for his quiet smile, quiet ways, and all of that. But when Larry was a young boy, he loved to be a cowboy. His boots, his little cap gun. I shall never forget. And this Steve was, when you were born, 1960, I went and stayed with Austin because Gene was working in the city. And when Matt Dillon and Gunsmoke came on, I see him strapping on his little pistol, cap pistol. And they always walked out there, and old Matt came down the street, and he always tried to outdrill a man. He was pretty quick. Old Lefty was pretty quick. And I've never forgotten that scene, him trying to outdrill Matt Dillon. And another thing, you know, he was always a good guy. Truly, he was. He was a good guy. And he was about, you can see this, not that high, okay? And the bad guy was sneaking up behind him. And they live in the home, and I'll describe it just a little bit. What we call brick siding is like asbestos shingles, had that grid on it, you know? And the guy's getting real close to him, and Larry whirls and pops the bad guy, and then he caught the house. And ripped his knuckles really bad. That's Larry, okay? And so many things, and I don't want to say so many things that Phyllis will not have anything left. I'm sure she'll have plenty. We all grew up together. And my wife wished me to relate a story. She lived with Lois and Jean while she was young, and before I actually met her. And but anyway, Larry and Steve, one day, they was all playing around, and they pushed her into a very deep 12-foot bathtub. And she fell across down in it, you know, I think legs hanging out, and she couldn't get out, and so they were just backing off, just laughing very, very heartily at her predicament of being down there in the bathtub and not able to get out. But that was him. He was fun-loving. And I hope she'll never, never, never forget him. So happy for the days that we spent together. And you're going to miss him very much. Larry, I'm thankful that I know that when we are in Christ, amen, that we have eternal life through him. That there's a heavenly home that's prepared for us, and that we shall meet again. Until we do, God bless.
Impossible to sum up a life so well lived in a matter of moments. So just like his own personal classics, such as Have Yourself a Hairy Little Mistress, or There Might Be a Little Dust on Her Bottom, we'll call this Larry Dunlap's greatest hits. For those who don't know me, I'm Amber Dunlap, Jeff's wife and Larry's only daughter-in-law. But I could also just say I was his third daughter, because that's how he always treated me. He was everyone's dad. Larry and Diana are the most welcoming and loving couple. In my 23 years as a member of this family, their door has always been open, and many holidays and family gatherings have included extra seats at the table. Larry and Diana always made sure people had a place to go and a family to welcome them. I can look around this room and see faces of several of those Dunlap adoptees. Speaking of love and togetherness, we jokingly call Larry and Diana PB&J because they were perfectly made for each other and you never saw one without the other. They drove together, worked around the house and cabin together, even ordered one meal to split when they would go out. I've already told Jeff I will always order my own food because I don't share some of it. But that example of true lifelong friendship has been such a joyful experience and very entertaining to watch. It's not to say they had a perfect marriage or a perfect life, though we'd all have to look pretty hard to find the flaws. Diana describes their last day together as the perfect day, even though it started with her telling him he needed a hearing aid. She just mumbles. He always joked that the internet ruined it for him because now people could look up his ridiculous claims. As we laughed, while they bickered back and forth, Larry started to say, "Well, I heard," and Diana interrupted with, "You don't know, you haven't heard." And that is still the phrase my family uses with each other when one of us gets a little too big for our britches. "You don't know, you haven't heard." If you spent any time with him at all, I'm sure you've heard Diana's tone when she says, "Larry." Diana will tell you they weren't perfect, but with 50 years together, I think we can all say that they lived and loved so well.
Amen.
Jeff and I have talked about the future, realizing we won't have our parents forever, and we've not been able to really grasp what that means. Losing Larry shocked us all, and we thought we would have more time with him. In these moments of pain and heartache, it's easy to sometimes say, "Where was God when all of this happened?" But let me tell you, God has been so beautifully present with all of us in unique ways. Diana and Larry experienced one final perfect day together. My dad had sent me a scripture verse that morning, Isaiah 41:10. "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And a text message saying he was praying for me because he knew things could be stressful. I took it as referring just to everyday life, but as I have pulled it out and read it several times over this week, I see how God was preparing me and covering us before any of us knew we would need it. And some of Larry's grandkids are going to share their own stories next. Larry was a quiet, godly man, but like a stone landing on the smooth surface of the water, the ripples of his life extend so far out. As you can see in the hundreds of comments on Facebook, every person that came through to see us last night, and every person sitting here today, every person whose life intersected with Larry's, we are all examples of how far one person's reach can go. If you've ever been at a Dunlap birthday gathering, you know it's not complete without a rendition of Happy Birthday in four-part harmony. No one will ever fill Larry's part for us, but each time we sing, even such a simple song, I know we will hear him. I would have embarrassed him enough by now, so I'll end with this. He's an irreplaceable man that we are all blessed to call family or friend. And I know he's up there next to Jesus, finally realizing that heaven uses to ply toilet paper.
I'm going to introduce myself, although from the sounds of it, all of you look at me and I look like my father anyways. So. Hello, my name is Leah Dunlap. I'm the daughter of Jeff and Amber Dunlap. My dad is Larry and Diana's middle child. I'm Larry and Diana's middle grandchild. So, like my father, I have always considered myself to be the favorite child, despite the stereotypes that come with being the middle child. With that being said, in reality, my papa loves all of his kids and all of his grandkids equally. My papa is kind and wise and smart. He loves everyone he's ever met, and everyone who's met him loves him too, as is evident by the not enough chairs in this room. He has been a role model for and one of the strongest men in my life. I will always love and cherish the memories of my papa. I look forward to every moment with him, and his wisdom is beyond anyone's I've ever met. No one and nothing can prepare you for a loss like this. That is, no one except my God. I truly believe God has been preparing me for this for around the last year. He has left me little things here and there to help me grieve. The first most obvious sign was from two missed phone calls. Each year on our birthdays, Mama and Papa call us to sing Happy Birthday. Two times I've missed their calls. At the time, it made me sad, but now I realize how much of a blessing it was. On both of those calls, Mama and Papa left voicemails. Now I can listen to those voicemails on my phone. I get to hear his voice, I get to hear him sing, and at the end of one of the recordings, Papa says, "Love you, Leah, love you. Bye-bye, babe." I will hold on to this forever. The next one was one of my papa's jackets. He gave me one a couple months ago, and it was the only thing that could console me the night he died. It's a simple pullover jacket that it either didn't fit him anymore or he just didn't want it, but now it means the world to me. Another moment I had was on the Sunday before his death. A headlight was out on my car, so my boyfriend, two of my friends, and I stood outside while my dad taught us how to fix it. I was not very good at it. We were outside, and we heard sirens and saw emergency vehicles pulling into the street next to us. And I used to live on that street, so me and my friends all walked around the block to make sure everyone was okay. Once we got to that street, I saw the EMS vehicles right by my Nana's house, so I sped up extra to make sure my Nana was okay. But we got up to the house, and it was one of her neighbors having issues. He appeared to be okay and well taken care of, so the four of us stayed with my Nana, and we talked to her for a while. We had great conversations with her, and when my two friends had to leave, my boyfriend and I stayed a while longer. My boyfriend lost his grandfather fairly recently, so as we were leaving my Nana's house, he told me to spend as much time as I could with her. This hit me really hard. Finally, we have all the ways God prepared me on Tuesday, the day of his death. I woke up that morning feeling exhausted. During lunch at school, I called my mom to ask her to skip youth group so that I could stay home and rest. I told her I just wanted to shower and go to bed early. She said that was fine, so after school I went straight home. I sat on the couch and went on a walk with my mom and my dog. I hadn't done that in a while. I got home, showered, took a bath, and headed to the kitchen. I ate too much food. Like, way too much food. Like, I definitely should have felt sick, but I didn't feel sick. I felt nicely full. One of the items I ate was Cheerios and bananas. And anyone who's met my pawpaw and seen him eat breakfast knows that that is a pawpaw special. I have only eaten that meal outside his house twice in my life, and that was one of the times. I put everything away and went to bed. When I was woken up by my Nana around 12:55 in the morning, I knew something was wrong. I thought someone had turned my alarm off and I had slept until the afternoon. But no, it was the middle of the night. The last time my Nana woke me up in the middle of the night, my parents had my sister in the hospital for an allergic reaction. I thought my sister was in danger. Thanks a lot. But my Nana came into my room and she told me, "I am okay. Your mom and dad are okay. Everyone in your household is okay, but I have some bad news, so I need you to wake up." She then told me my papa had died. I sobbed. I got up, got ready, and mentally prepared myself to help my sister through the horror of waking up to her grandpa dying. We got up to my mama and papa's house, and I was well rested and full of food because of the night before. Although I could have never been mentally ready for my papa to pass, God gave me the opportunity to be physically strong. Right now, all we have is God, our family, and prayers. Physically, all I have left of my papa are his belongings. But emotionally, he has left me with much more. He's left me with the kind legacy of his last name. He's left me with memories of his wisdom and his jokes that always make me laugh. He's left me with beautiful pictures of his joyful smile. Most importantly, he has left me with his love of God. I will not let another moment of my life be wasted. I will cherish the time I have with my family and try to leave a positive influence on everyone I encounter, just like my papa did. Before I introduce my cousins, I want to leave you all with an important Bible verse my mom taught me and my sister when we were younger. It goes like this. God's message, the God who created the cosmos, stretched out the skies, laid out the earth and all that grows from it, who breathes life into earth's people, makes them alive with his own life. I am God. I have called you to live right and well. I have taken responsibility for you, kept you safe. That's Isaiah 42:5-6. I know my God is here for me and my family. In these hard times, rely on him and please keep us in your prayers. Here are my cousins, Jocelyn, Jonah, Jean, Jude, Joel. This is my sister Sadie and my cousins Jason and Jess here right up front with my family. Thank you all for being here for my family today. I'm sorry we've all had to grieve this great loss today.
Yeah, I was debating on whether I wanted to speak, but yeah, anything for my grandma. It was so unexpected. I was just with him the night before Dad. He seemed fine. We were just hanging out and just joking. We were gonna go fishing, but it was too windy. Then the next night, I got off work. Dad called me at 11 o'clock. He's usually asleep at least for like an hour or two before that, so something was up. And so they're going over. And I took a quick shower just in case. And good thing I took a shower. But, yeah, restaurants, you don't smell good afterwards. called me again, and just like that, about 2 seconds, I didn't know what to say. My eyes just glazed over, and I threw them closed, and drove over. That was the longest drive I've ever had in my life. I walked in, and my whole world was crushed. He was strong, of course, but there he wasn't. I knew he wouldn't be around forever. And he's had surgeries, so we knew his heart wasn't what it used to be. But, my God, it just feels like a fever dream. I know he's gone, but it's so hard to wrap my mind around. I know he's not hurting anymore, and God took him quick. I'm just glad he didn't stop her, but I don't know, I'm not fine. I know my family isn't, I know. I don't know what to do. But she could just wake up and it'd be some terrible dream. My grandma said that he did all his favorite things on Tuesday. And I'm just glad he got to go to the park and go ride around side by side. And I heard they danced before they went to bed, and then they prayed for all of us like they did every single day. And it just means he was thinking about us right up until the moment he went. And I'm just thankful he cared about me and his very present. There isn't a whole lot I wouldn't do just to have one more conversation. Just chat it up one more time, ask for some guidance, and I'd tell him everything. He was my role model, and he's someone I always aspired to be like. And his legacy embodied kindness, hard work, and love he demonstrated throughout his whole life. I know there's no shortage of great people around me. I'm very fortunate, but my God, he set the bar high. Even from the beginning when he met you, Mama, he sent you 2 dozen roses. I've never bought flowers for anybody. He worked so hard and did it with excellence. And he made sure he took good care of his family. He treated people with love and respect. And all my life, he was a godly example. And as of recent, I've passed years, so I begin to understand why he led the life he lived. I'm blessed to have 20 years with him. But I'm going to be selfish and want a little more. I knew he wasn't going to be around forever, but I thought he'd be around just a little longer than Tuesday. Why not? His time came, but I still needed him. There's some things I wanted to share and accomplish with him. His belief in me is my driving force. And has his absence leaves me feeling empty. I've been told by several people that he's looking down from heaven, watching over me, or he's my guardian angel walking beside me or something. But I don't know how much of that actually rings true, but how much of it is bullcrap. But I do know. was present while he was present for me while I was here, and he made a point to be involved in my life. So maybe he's still watching me. So I pop up here, listen. I love you. I miss you so much. I'm always a little buddy.
I didn't really prepare anything, so excuse me if I start rambling. Papa was one of the most loving and caring people I knew. He just cared so much and loved every single person. If you know me, you know I have a bad habit of signing up for every sport under the sun. And he came to everything. He came to my races, my games, he came to my shows, my competitions. And whatever I was doing at the time, he would always tell me stories about it too. Back whenever I did Taekwondo, he'd tell me stories about karate and boxing and all kinds of martial arts. My favorite story he ever told me though, whenever I was doing cross country or distance running, he told me about how back whenever he was in the Army, whenever at boot camp, he was one of the fastest runners there, maybe even the fastest. He could beat my mile time by like a couple minutes, all but wearing combat boots. Any time we were doing a long run day, when my coaches would make us run like 6 or 7 miles, I would just think about that. So he was a really strong believer in God, and I know he loved all of you.
Thank you for everything you've done for our family. Before I start my speech, I just like to say what a good man he was. He's always so positive.
Thank you. awesome. Now it's Papa's first grand baby. Not really sure where he starts and just had pointers. But Papa was a great man. He was a great example of a man and how to be one. He set the bar high, especially with the love he had for us and Mama. He was one of the hardest workers I know, while also the most humble. I'm sure we can all agree on that. He always wanted to help no matter where the help was needed. I want to share some memories with you all that I know will stick with me forever. First being his corn chips. Papa always had a good joke or a good story to tell. He would always tell me the same joke or story over and over again. Only because he would tell it and say it like it's the first time he could go over on this page. He would always laugh to make me laugh. He would make the joke funnier because he thought it was funny. Papa always called us girls babe and hun, and that will stick with us forever. He had so much love for us grandkids, and I know we all felt it. Some more memories I have with Papa are side-by-side ride. I mentioned once when we were going around the corner, we saw a big old cornfield on the right side, and it was gorgeous, and I said, wow, that's beautiful. Mama told me the other day that he brought it up every time they went around that corner. One time, me and Papa were riding the truck when I was a little girl, and I can't remember what he said, but I said, oh, really? And he started laughing and said, what did you say that for? And I said, that sign back there said, oh, really? Started laughing so hard, it was the O'Reilly sign.
One morning, I woke up and, you know, back at their house, I used to eat Cheerios and watch SpongeBob in the morning. And little by little, she had been outside earlier. And that day, he came back in, and he's like, "Hey, Jude, I found something outside. Come on." And so, followed him outside, and I was around, as he'd say, about yay high. And about five. And we went out there into their big old yard, and I found him what looked like deer poop. It was chocolate covered raisins. And I did not know that. So he said, "Hey, let's see if it's male or female." So he picked one of them, a couple of them up, and stuck them in his mouth. I was absolutely appalled. I was like, "Why is he eating deer poop?" I'm gonna miss him. He was a prankster. He was the greatest prankster of all, and thank you for everything you have done for my family over these past couple of days. It means the world to us. I love you, Popo. It's good to see you.
I've written out a million ways I was going to start this, and I don't think I'm good enough, so I will remember. Dear Popo, I don't know how to let you go. I don't want your face to turn into photographs. I don't want your voice to turn into videos to play in the last few seconds, so I don't forget what you sound like. I don't want to stop feeling important to you. I waited beside you until they took you away, and I just wanted to stop trying to tell you I love you as many times as I could, so you'll never forget when you stop feeling loved by me. I kept texting you the night it happened, hoping it was all a bad dream, and you just text me back some corny joke and it would all be over. I've never begged anyone to stay in life, but that night I found myself praying with everything in me that you just come back to us. I wish you could have known how much your presence affected me and everyone who came to cover it. You brought so much light and happiness in every room. You went in without even trying. And everyone knew and saw that. You were a hard worker, an honest friend, a loyal husband, an outstanding father, and the best papa I could have ever asked for. When they took you out of the house, I felt a part of me go with you. I'll never forget all the stories you told me or how humble you were. I will never forget your sweetness and your love. I'll never forget how good you were at seeing me even though you didn't think so. I'll never forget the way your face lit up when you saw me or how you'd say hey babe or hey hon every time you greeted me. I won't forget the jokes you told and your perfect smile. I won't forget how sharp you looked every Sunday morning or how you let the seatbelt alarm beep the whole 3-hour ride to Donovan. I won't forget how you tilted your head back when you laughed or how calm and comforted I felt when I was around you. I won't forget your gentleness or your compassion or your strength. And I will carry your kindness with me every day and spread it just as you did. And I will pass it down to my children and their children and never let it be forgotten. Your legacy will forever live on. You texted me about a week ago and told me, Jeannie, you're going to be a great lady, and I really mean that. You always made me feel like the most important girl in the room. You always say, Jean Claire, you're so beautiful, but I'd still love you if you weren't. Anytime I would tell you I loved you, you'd always say I loved you first. list of how you'd say I'm proud to be your papa, or how much you check in on me. I hate that it's all gone now, and I hate that I thought I had more time than I did. I have so much regret. There's so much evidence to do and say. Papa Ramadan said, I think I will ask God why for the rest of my life, and never will I come to understand it. Himself came in front of me and told me the reason, I don't think I would accept it. Some loves are too hard to bear, and with great love comes great pain, and with great loss comes the greatest pain of all. If love could have saved you, you would have lived forever. I'll never stop missing you. I love you more than everything, Papa. And like you ended every call, bye-bye.
Papa is so proud of you.
That was a great job, guys.
Tough setting. Great job. And my name is Phyllis Dunlap. We're tough. Larry and I were double cousins. Our mothers were sisters and our dads were cousins. So we're related on both sides. So we have, you know, a little cruise, you know, everywhere. Yeah, and the kids all call me aunt, so it's like, yeah, Larry was my brother. We grew up in that way. We grew up, first of all, my first memories are on Spring Avenue. And the Spring Avenue crew always included Dan and Larry. Steve, you came along later. my mom and dad and Aunt Wilson Cousin lived a little house, you know, one that you draw like this. Side by side, two rooms on each side, and it was Danny and Larry and Orson on one side, and me and my mom and dad on the other. And there was a back porch, and there was a refrigerator and a washing machine on the back porch. The ringer washer, guys, okay, no on that. And the refrigerator, I believe the refrigerator belonged to Aunt Lois and the washing machine to my mom. It was one way or the other, they shared. And they lived there in that little house together while they bought two lots up the street from Grandma and Grandpa, and they flipped a coin to see who got to pick the lot they wanted. Uncle Gene won the coin flip, and then our house got built first and then there. So we still live side by side. So we were neighbors there for years and years. And that crew included a couple of my aunts as well, who were younger, the older brother Danny. We ran that neighborhood. Blacks, you know, Grandma and Grandpa and us here, and Ann Arena over there with Glenn and Leonard and the other street had Aunt Ella May and those kids and Gary, and we all just congregated, and that was where we ran. And Larry and I were like brother and sister. He loved to read joke books. He liked fast cars, never mention that. He liked muscle cars, and he liked motorcycles. And he liked them as well as the whole cowboy thing. He's loved them since he was little. So we had that whole crew, and then later when we all moved to the country, then it was, there was a whole bunch of us down there. There was my sister Marilyn. I even wrote down the years of birth here. Y'all just can ignore it if you want to, but my sister was born in 52, Doyle. It was an uncle at 51, Larry at 50. I was in 48, Dale is another uncle at 46, Vinny at 44, and Danny at 43. So we were actually just, you know, one big family and hung out. The favorite things we did were jumping out of haylofts and playing Jesse James through the hills. And Vinny, you were going to tell the story about you guys running through those ditches or arroyos or whatever they were across there. They would shoot at each other with BB guns. But they waited until my sister and I were gone because they were afraid of my dad. Yeah, they also built a treehouse, and they built it themselves, one of his earlier building things. And it was unsafe enough that my dad forbid me to go up. Not that it mattered. If he was gone, I went up anyway. But that was probably his first building project, was the treehouse. There was also another tree there, and this was in our grandmother's yard. It was a cedar tree, and you know, if you know cedar trees, they grow,
you know, around there like stair steps going up like a spiral staircase. And it was a contest to see who could get to the top of the tree. Larry usually won because Doyle was younger, but he was heavier. And I was older, and there was no way those, when those branches started bending up at the top, when I got little, he would always win, but he, none of us ever got to the top. But he was always so happy because he was king of the cedar tree. And we all had guns strapped on, of course. My mom wouldn't buy me any because I was a girl, but Larry had plenty, so I always wanted to borrow one of his and a cowboy hat. And my mother kept my hair back in a nice neat ponytail, that really long, long hair. And as soon as she was gone, I jerked that rubber band out of it and put a cowboy hat on. And that's how we ran it all day long. That was the country stuff. Then there were the city things a little bit later. We moved back into town. Larry was a prankster even then. Okay, anybody know about party telephone lines? Yes. You know, party telephone. Yeah, Grandma had one. And whenever she wasn't home, we listened in on the neighbor's phone. Party lines were gone, and we had our own phone, and somewhere over on Benton Street, Larry got the bright idea that we should do some of his jokes on the phone. So we got on the telephone and called random people out of the phone book and said, we're from the electric company. I don't remember what the electric company was. We're from the electric company. We want to check and see if your refrigerator is running. And some people would actually go check. You know, the refrigerator is running, and you know the next line, right? Until one day, some guy answered the phone, and we tried one of those. And he told us that he had a machine on his phone, and that it was recording us, and that it was going to the police station. It was kind of the end of our whole career because we had long conversations about, can we really do that or not? Now, I know you guys, you know, with all this color ID and all this stuff, but really, in the old days, the phone rang, you picked it up and answered it, you did not know who it was. And if you went traveling on a long trip, then you called where it would be long distance, you know, and you had to pay a whole lot of money for that, like $1.25. And so when you went on a long trip and you want to let somebody know you got there, you would call and let it ring twice and hang up and then you got there. We knew all about those things, but, and on Benton, one of the places on Benton Street, there was a laundry chute. And Lois never did catch us, but we slid down the laundry chute. That was just lucky. Yeah, we wrapped ourselves in a blanket because you didn't want to eat your splinters or whatever, and slide down the laundry chute. Oh, yes. And he was a champion in that too, because I would finally get, you know, a little scared because I was older. I was older by a couple of years. I was pretty much going to get stuck in the closet. But he was always courageous in that way, yes. Country, the other thing, when you guys were talking about the doping and all of that, we would go fishing in the pond on our farm. And he found, I don't know, we had homemade fishing poles and lines and hooks somewhere. He probably, you know, just found them somewhere. But my sister, I'm sorry, I'm going to the bus now. My sister was afraid we'd catch grasshoppers to get bait. So, and she didn't like either catching grasshoppers, and she certainly wasn't about to put a hook in the lid. He would have always bait her hook. Just always bait her hook for her. She'd be like, oh. I didn't like it, but I wouldn't have let on because I had to be as tough as he was. I wouldn't have made her hook for her, though. We were in the St. Charles Church together as well as teenagers for a while. And those were the days when he liked the fast cars. He had that little Dodge Dart, and I don't know what he did to make it run. perfectly fast, but there were any number of times when either I was at the house and he would come in and, oh, this is another old days thing, you know. The cops couldn't radio ahead, they couldn't check on the license plate, and if you just drove, you know, fast enough, they couldn't get it. So get away down the street, and you had to turn in real fast and pull the car right behind the house, and then jump out and run in the house so there's nobody there, and then the cops would run up and down the street for, you know, 2 hours while we all hid out. Yes, those were the days. Oh, well, yeah. I'm not offering any suggestions. Some ways you need to be like your papa, and other ways, okay, maybe not quite. We were in the St. Charles Church together, though, and he did love to play music. Was a friend to everybody.
Yes.
I don't know anybody who just liked music at all. I think I was the only person he ever fought with, and that probably wasn't Larry's fault. Everybody loved him. He was kind, he was caring, all of the things that everyone else has said. The last thing I want to do is read scripture out of, oh well, I copied this in my brain, just forgot where it's at. Ecclesiastes chapter 6. Faithful friends are a sturdy shelter. Whoever finds one has found the treasure. Faithful friends are beyond price. No amount can balance their worth. Faithful friends are life-saving medicine, and those who fear the Lord will find them. Those who fear the Lord direct their friendship aright, for as they are, so are their neighbors also. And my exhortation to you guys is, remember to be a friend to all. It didn't matter to him whether you were high or low, had money or didn't have money, were cute or ugly, even still love. Absolutely, and it was true for everybody. He was a friend, and it's a challenge to all of us as well. Just be a friend. We've lost a great friend today. I lost a brother, and while we grieve his loss, we can remember the good parts and remember the parts to emulate, because he really did love people, and he would do anything to help anybody. God bless you. Thank you.
myself in case you don't know who I am. I'm Larry's favorite son-in-law. He has always been my favorite father-in-law. Some of you that don't know me thinking, what's going on here? He's my oldest father-in-law. And he definitely, Larry and I are my favorite in-laws. You go to family church, you'll hear me say that a couple times a year. I say it as a joke, but with all sincerity, they are my favorites. They say, I'm not sure who they is, but they're correct. Whoever said it first says, when you marry the daughter, you marry the family. They're right. So, as a single guy, I was 28 and a half years old. Some of you remember my first trip to St. Louis, right? To visit Jennifer. But as a single guy, I had a list. It wasn't a very long list. You know, I thought I was enough to have a list, you know. I'll just tell you a few things that were on my list when I was, you know, praying and seeking God, you know, if I was going to take that next step in getting married. Now, these are not necessarily in the order I had them in, but I numbered them 1 through 4 here. She has to love the Lord. She has to be smarter than me. Definitely has to be hot smoking. And one that was very important to me, I had to love her family.
Yes.
And I definitely loved Jennifer's family. First time I met Jennifer face to face was on Larry and Diana's 25th wedding anniversary weekend. Jennifer and Jeff and Julie have put together a beautiful, wonderful anniversary to celebrate. And I came in town to visit, and I got to meet many of you there that weekend. And from there, I was sold. Even if she runs off and leaves me, I'm keeping the family. But throughout the years, one of my favorite memories, and I had the privilege of going over to their house and living there in the basement a few times, and coming upstairs early in the morning, and there he's at the dinner table, breakfast table, with his bananas, Cheerios, and but his Bible and devotion time was always there. Even if he had just a few moments, he made time for Bible and Cheerios. It's such a wonderful thing to see that he carried on that as a daily part of his life. He made woodwork look so easy. And I can't remember who it was, but I had the opportunity to work with Dunlap Builders for a number of years, and someone says, I just love working for Larry. I said, really? Well, why is that? Because he didn't work for Larry all the time, but he came in spurts and worked for Larry. He goes, I love Larry Dunlap and Steve Dunlap so much. But one thing about Larry that I love more than any other boss is he doesn't tell you to do something. There could be a 100 2x4s stacked right there that you need to move from here to here. Larry would never tell you to move. And Larry would always ask you, could you please move these over here for me? I noticed that, the kindness, the thoughtfulness that he had. If I could pick out a couple Bible verses, one of them that would be at the very top would be the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. John chapter 13, verse 35 says this, by this all will know that you're my disciples if you have love for one another. That was a beautiful verse of scripture that I think Larry took to heart and tried to implement day in and day out with everyone. He loved the Lord, he loved his family, he loved his friends. He was truly gifted with the gift of help. A wonderful example that I try to take to heart every single day. He helped others and friends and family, many people that will never know how he helped finances in investing time in and repairing houses and things for moms and widows and giving advice, listing and discounts and he just didn't sail up, but he took the time to show you that he really, really loved you. You know, I could probably ask 100 people in here today, were you and Larry best friends? And you probably say, oh yeah, me and Larry were great friends. Everybody was Larry's best friend. That's how he made you feel. You felt better talking. You may be having the crummiest day, but by the time you're leaving Larry's presence, you think, you know, everything's going to be all right. Everything is going to be all right. The last sermon that Larry got to hear me preach. Joel mentioned it. James said this, the book of James, the New Testament, said, life is but a vapor.
Yeah.
It's here a little while and then it's gone, right? So pretend this rope. This is about a 40-foot rope here. I'm not going to unwind it, but no, it's a 40-foot rope. And this red end right here, that's our life. Statistics say we live an average of 70-something years. But this rope, it goes on forever.
Amen.
Pretend it's your timeline.
Amen.
And this red end, it represents your timeline. We just have a few years. Some people, all they do is they think about the red part. 60, 70, 80 years. They say, work hard here. Save, save, save. And you just kind of get consumed with that. And when you get right out here, I'm going to spend it. I'm going to travel. I'm going to eat whatever I want. But what about this? The rest of your existence. Because when we're done with the red tape, we're going to live on and on and on in eternity. What's crazy to think about that some people, they forget that what you do here determines what happens here.
Yeah.
Millions and millions and millions of years forever. At times, maybe I or maybe all of us could pause for just a moment and think about how we spend so much time focusing on the wrong things. Here, we focus on distractions. At some point as you read the books that Paul wrote in the New Testament, the epistles, Paul began to say this, my life, it's like running a race, and I'm not going to be distracted anymore. I'm going to stop focusing on fill in the blank. He said, I'll put some things behind me. And Paul began to say, now I'm going to start looking forward. I'm going to start reaching forward in the things that Christ wants to do in my life. And watch Christ begin to change my life and start focusing on the prize that Jesus Christ has for me in every single one of us. We have one chance.
One chance.
We all just get one life. I want you to know this. There's no do-overs. When you die, you get to stand before the Lord at any moment. And then comes eternity. What you do with Jesus Christ, that is what's going to affect your eternity. At times, we looked at Larry at times and we talked, is he crazy? Some of the things he did was just not logical. Made no sense at the time. We told him he needed to raise his prices. He gave a lot of guys their first carpenter job. Got it pointed in the right direction. But now I look back at Larry's life, and Jennifer, you said this the other day. Larry lived life with a such bigger view, a bigger focus. He lived life with a big picture. He wasn't just building homes. He was building lives. He loved helping people. He loved blessing people. Those that God would bring into his life, he loved giving to them and encouraging someone and leaving them better than he found them. I want to ask you this morning, please, just don't live for the red part. Think about the big picture of your life and eternity with Jesus. I want to encourage you, all of us this morning, to live your life, to hear two words from the Lord. Live for the well done. I want to live for the well done. The other night, as we were pulling out of the driveway, I remember that almost every time we went over to Larry Dine's house, it could have been just fishing the lake or picking up a shovel, bar or tool, or coming over for Sunday lunch. When it was time to leave, you could have spent just 5 minutes there or all afternoon. Larry was going to walk you out. I don't know if he just wanted me to leave. But they know the true meaning of Southern hospitality. And sweet tea. Maybe he followed you out just to let you know he appreciated you stopping by. Or maybe make sure things okay before you get on the road. Maybe to share a couple more stories or jokes. Yeah. He would go inside. Till you backed up, turned around, and you were headed down the road. You see him put a head up. See you. Come back soon. Today, Larry, we have walked with you as far as we can. We've reached the end of the driveway. We bid you a farewell till we meet again. In the sweet bye-bye, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
My dad was a singer, and he had a beautiful voice. And on Sunday, we had church and we had worship service, and I told our team we were missing him and having just kind of a hard time getting into the swing of things. And I told them that the scripture says to be absent from your body is to be present with the Lord. And I know that my dad, or I know that my dad is in the presence of the Lord, and I can't imagine that he's there and that he's not worshiping. And so we want to just spend these last few moments worshiping. And I have part of our worship team here, but I know that half of us plays can sing really nice, so we want you to sing with us. And just kind of be a choir. We're going to worship today. We're going to worship the Lord. And we're, I know my dad is singing along with us. I know he's doing that.
When peace is alive,
Sure. So I hear him say, "Well done, Johnson." Someday I'll be walking down fishing in that Crystal Sea, Chris. Maybe I'll see Larry fishing too.